Welcome to The Explainer. Today we're going to break down one of the biggest dilemmas in all of economics, the Phillips curve. It's all about a tough choice, a trade-off that pretty much every government has to deal with. You know, this is the question that keeps policymakers up at night. We all want a booming economy with plenty of jobs, right? But that often comes with a price tag, literally. The cost of everything goes up. On the flip side, if you get those prices stable, you might see fewer jobs out there. So, what gives? Do we always have to choose one over the other? Let's find out. All right, so to really get to the bottom of this, we've got to start with the basic theory. It's a surprisingly simple idea, but man, is it powerful. It's been shaping economic policy for decades. So, what is the Phillips curve? Well, at its heart, it's all about this inverse relationship. The best way to think about it is like a seesaw. When one side, say unemployment, goes down, the other side, inflation, tends to go up. And if you push inflation down, you'll probably see unemployment start to rise. Simple as that, right?
Well, not quite. That's the textbook theory, but we all know the real world is a lot messier. So is this relationship set in stone? Is it a hard and fast rule? Or does it change? To figure that out, we've got to look at the numbers. Okay, let's pull back the curtain and see how economists actually model this thing. We're going to walk through the calculations step by step to see exactly how this trade-off gets measured.
All right, let's start with year one. Here's our setup. We've got inflation sitting at 10.25%, and the actual unemployment rate is 8%. Now, economists have this idea of a natural rate of unemployment, sort of the baseline for a healthy economy, and in our case, that's 5%. But here's the kicker, and this is super important. What did people expect inflation to be? A whopping 12.5%. So those are all our starting pieces. Okay, don't get scared by the formula here. It might look a little intense, but it's actually pretty straightforward. All it's saying is that the inflation we see today is really based on two big things. One, what we thought it was going to be, and two, how far off we are from that natural unemployment rate. And see that little Greek letter, beta? That's our magic number. It's the sensitivity factor, telling us just how strong this trade-off really is. So let's just plug our numbers from year one right into this thing. Actual inflation is 10.25%, expected inflation was 12.5%, and the unemployment gap, that's just 8% minus 5%. See? The only thing we don't know is beta.
And boom, after a little bit of quick math, we find out that beta is 0.75. This is our sensitivity factor. I like to think of it as the secret recipe for the trade-off in this specific economy. And now that we found it, we can really start to figure things out.
Awesome. We've got our secret recipe. And now for the cool part, we can actually use it to make a prediction. So let's fast forward to year two and see what happens when things start to change. Okay, here's the scene in year two. Inflation has cooled off a bit, down to 9%. But, and pay close attention here, look at what happened to expectations. They've updated. People are now expecting 10.25% inflation, which is exactly what it was last year. See how that works? For now, we'll assume our recipe, our beta, is still the same.
We're using the exact same formula, but this time we're trying to find a different missing piece of the puzzle, the new unemployment rate. So we plug in our new 9% inflation, our new expectation of 10.25%, and our good old beta, 0.75.
And the answer we get is 6.67%. Wait a second, hold on, let's rewind. Inflation went down, right? From over 10% to 9%. But unemployment also went down from 8% to under 7%. That's not supposed to happen. That's not a trade-off, that's getting the best of both worlds. So what on earth is going on?
The answer, and this is where it gets really interesting, is that we weren't just moving to a different spot on the seesaw. The entire seesaw moved. The whole curve shifted. And figuring out why it shifted? Well, that's the whole point.
Just look at this. The single biggest difference between year one and year two isn't the actual numbers. It's the expectations, what people thought was going to happen. That number dropped from a high 12.5% all the way down to 10.25%. And trust me, that's not just some small detail. It changes everything. And right there, that's the big aha moment. When people's expectations about inflation come down, the entire trade-off, the whole relationship, it shifts. It's like the rules of the game just changed. And all of a sudden, a much better outcome, lower inflation and lower unemployment, is actually possible.
Okay, to really hammer this point home, let's play a little what-if game. What if inflation still dropped to 9% in year two, but people's expectations didn't change? What if everyone was still pessimistic and they were stuck thinking inflation would be that high 12.5% from last year?
So we're going to run the same calculation. The only thing we're going to do is swap out that new expectation and put the old, higher 12.5% back in its place. Everything else is identical. The only variable we're changing is what's in people's heads. It's just psychology. And the result? It's kind of shocking. Instead of that nice 6.67% unemployment, the rate would have been a painful 9.66%. That's a huge difference. Think about that. You get the exact same amount of inflation, but the economy takes a much bigger hit with way more people out of work. And it's all because of what we expected to happen.
This comparison really lays it all out, doesn't it? When expectations are lower and under control, you get a 6.67% unemployment rate. But when they're high and all over the place, you get a much worse 9.66%. It's the same economy, the same inflation rate, but a completely different belief about the future creates two totally different worlds.
Okay, we've been deep in the weeds with the math. Let's pull back and look at the big picture, because this isn't just some abstract classroom exercise, right? This stuff has massive implications for all of us in the real world. So let's boil this whole thing down. One, yes, there's a short-term trade-off. It's real. Two, but, and this is a big but, it's not set in stone. The whole thing can move. Three, and what moves it? Our collective expectations about the future. That's the secret sauce. Which brings us to the biggest takeaway of all. A central bank's most important job isn't just messing with interest rates. It's managing our beliefs. It's convincing all of us that the future is stable.
And that right there is the heart of modern economics. The Phillips curve isn't some simple menu where you can just pick a little more inflation for a little less unemployment. It's more like a dynamic map, and the terrain is constantly shifting based on how we all feel about the future. So the real goal isn't to pick a spot on the map. It's to try and move the entire map to a better neighborhood.
Which, of course, leads us to the big question for today. In our crazy complex world, with supply chains breaking, global pandemics, and AI changing everything, do these old rules even apply anymore? Is the trade-off still there? Has the curve flattened out or maybe disappeared completely? Honestly, that's the billion-dollar question that everyone, from central bankers to top economists, is trying to figure out right this very minute.